It was all good. It was all peaceful. And everything was more scary. I feel we are ready. By delaying is only hurting us more and more.
Yeah. Hey, Craig.
Okay, it's 5 o'clock. So good afternoon and welcome to the Administration, Finance, Recreation, and Parks, Public Safety, and Public Works Regular Committee Meeting for June 12, 2018. The purpose of these committee meetings are for the city departments to pass along information to the city council and discuss initiatives listed on the published agenda. This is a public meeting, but not a public hearing. Therefore, while the meeting is open to the public, we will not take public comments or questions during the committee meetings. Public comments or questions are received at the regular city council meetings held at 7 p.m. here in the city council chambers on the second and fourth Monday of each month. The first item on the agenda is the approval of amendments for the administration, finance, and recreation of Parks Committee meeting for May 15, 2018. Is there a motion?
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve by Councilman Judy. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilman Groer. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Next item on the agenda, number two under administration, consideration of a resolution to allow scarecrows in the city of Roswell lighting. Chris is here to also just hold up.
So, good evening, afternoon. This resolution is going to allow businesses to place scarecrows in the city of Roswell's right of way. It's by the Roswell Women's Club, and it's called the 2018 Booyah Scarecrow Event. It will run between September 28th and November 1st. They will be asked to apply for an encroachment permit, which I'm working with Muhammad right now. We ask that they have a tag no larger than 8.5 by 11, nothing else on the tag. And this is businesses, neighborhoods, families, and they can enter, the entry is free.
Motion to approve. Motion to approve by Councilman Palermo. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilman Zapata. Any discussion? All in favor say aye. Any opposed? Thanks, Chris.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda, consideration of reinstating transcribing services of the audio recording for all meetings of the mayor and city council and council committees. In front of you is a memo that I just did and passed out, which kind of recaptures the same information I put in the memo for March 28th. That was the first time that we had this item come before the committee. I would like to run through this and kind of just frame for context some of these issues that we have that were in the March 28th memo and some additional information that may help you guys make an informed decision. So for context, the city currently does the following. The city video and audio records and publishes all city council meetings. The city audio records and publishes the Planning Commission, DZA, HBC, and DRB meetings. So for this case here, a little bit of the history. In 2014 and 2016, the city hired two part-time transcriptionists to transcribe the audio for all city council meetings at a cost of around $30,000 annually. The city also has an ongoing contract with an individual located in Southern Georgia. I don't remember her name offhand. To transcribe the audio Planning Commission, BZA, HPC, and DRB meetings at a cost of around $16,000 annually. We've been doing that since about 2001. February 2018, at my direction, we ceased transcribing all city council meeting minutes. The two part-time transcriptionists were assigned duties related to public records requests and other duties that you generally find in the city clerk's office. So March 28th, at the committee meeting, Councilmember Zapata raised the issue of transcribing and led a discussion about reinstating the transcribing of the audio from all city council meetings. The city council agreed at that committee meeting to follow. To reinstate the transcription services starting with the next council meeting, with the transcriptionist only transcribing the discussion and action surrounding items to be voted upon, otherwise known as action items. Research and report on the following within 30 days, and that was assigned to me. The viability and cost of the software to transcribe. Assess the skill and qualification of the current transcriptionist. Viability and cost of hiring a court reporter stenographer for each city council meeting. Research and provide feedback on the best practices of local government in regard to this activity and transparency in general. This was to come back at the April 10th, 2018 committee meeting. So we placed it on that agenda. And at that meeting, we deferred to the next of the May meeting because Councilmember Zapata was not here. We discussed it briefly, but didn't really get into it too much. So we came back on May 15th and deferred that to this meeting because I wasn't here. So that's where we're at on this item. So to go back to the research that I was supposed to conduct in the March 28th meeting. So the viability and cost of the trick on the software transcribe. So the research, the limited research I did, I read some articles and transcription software service seemed to be the one that was the most on top of the game with this activity. So I researched that and got a demo. And theirs is a flat fee of $120 a month. And that's for 10 hours of audio transcription. And that's $12 thereafter. When I put a sample of that audio transcription in this memo, and it was also in your packets on the 28th, so I'm going to make a track on the 28th. And you can see from that sample that the tech just isn't there yet. The next one was assess the skill and qualifications of the current transcriptionist. So we have a job description, which is also in this memo packet and from the 28th. And the job description doesn't call for them to be stenographers. I don't know if they have that qualification or not, but we're not asking for that. So we don't have certified court stenographers on staff in this job. So the next one is viability and cost of hiring a court reporter stenographer for each mayor and city council. The research I did in the local court reporting services, Appalachian Court Reporting. So to report the monthly meetings, they would charge $400 appearance fee each time, and then $6 per page of transcription. So the number of pages taken down per hour can vary, but the general estimate is roughly 45 pages in an hour. So a three-hour meeting would cost us about $1,200 for that meeting, and for all the meetings we have, generally it would cost about $60,000 a year to have a transcription of service do the transcribing of the audio. So last item that I was to research was to look at the best practices of local government on this activity and in general on transparency. So I reached out to the ICMA, the International City County Managers Association, and the Alliance for Innovation, which is also a strategic partner of the ICMA. We're a member of the Alliance for Innovation and ICMA. And transcribing and publishing audio of meetings is not identified as a best practice in municipal government. I spoke to several colleagues and my counterparts that I know from around the nation in varying sized cities. All of them live stream their council meetings and quasi-judicial subordinate bodies of the council, like the Planning Commission, BZA. All of them record, archive, and publish their meetings through their website, but none provide transcription of the meeting audio, nor do they know of any other city that does this type of activity. So in conclusion, the city is currently paying a direct cost of around $46,000 annually to transcribe audio of city meetings, $30,000 for the city council and $16,000 for the other meetings. We video, audio record, and publish all city council meetings. And starting this fall, we will add live streaming to those city council meetings as well. The activity of transcribing the audio of our meetings is not identified as a best practice in municipal government, nor is it identified as an ADA best practice, and could have some adverse legal implications for the city if we do continue. And I'll defer Bob in a second. So in my opinion, and it is my recommendation, the public and our organization is better served by redirecting resources used for transcribing to assist the city clerk's office with public records and other service activities within that office. So I thought that you want to talk a little bit about some of the legal implications.
Well, as I discussed before, from a legal point of view, before we had the verbatim transcripts as the minutes, and no other city in Georgia does that. Minutes are legally the record of what is on the agenda, what the motion was, and what the decision was. that's what's legally required and that's what the courts look to. I saw or heard from others that people took what I said before about how the words, verbatim words, can be twisted when appeals are taken from zoning cases as the city trying to hide something. That's not the fact at all. My point was that developers' lawyers can take remarks that council members make at the dais when you're speaking off the cuff and use them against you. As I said before, when you make a decision, if you just let your vote speak for you, then the court will supply the reasoning that they think is appropriate behind that decision. If you go ahead and have that other, there have been instances where we in court have been hampered in trying to defend decisions of counsel. So that's the danger, not hiding anything, because I believe we are one of the most transparent governments out there, and I think that's a good thing, but we have all these different sources and ways to do it. The other point that I would address that was raised before is about the Americans with Disabilities Act, and according to the U.S. Justice Department, we have to accommodate anyone who asks. City governments must give primary consideration to the type of auxiliary aid or service that an individual with a disability requests. The final decision is the government's. So it recognizes the municipal government's ability to try to address the transparency any way that it deems best. So legally, there's no reason to do it. There is also an inconsistency. As we're doing now, we have an unofficial verbatim transcript, and we have the official minutes. That can set up legal problems as well. So I just, no other city in Georgia does it, and I don't recommend that we do it.
So with that all up before?
So my take on this is, with the live streaming coming up this fall, the investment in it, the videotaping of every single meeting, publishing, archiving with the chaptering of that. And when your city administrator and your legal counsel says, this is not a best practice, good idea, or a place to put money, I can't support that. Based upon that, and when you say, you know, as somebody said earlier, 600 cities in the state of Georgia, nobody else does this, there's probably a reason why. And so for me, when I'll take staff's recommendation on this.
So for me, the points I'm hearing, I absolutely understand that other cities do not do it. But for me, that's not even a point of consideration. For me, I want to think about what is the best thing to do. And that's where I really hope we can frame this conversation. What is best for the city of Roswell? What is best for the residents of Roswell? I absolutely am very focused on costs. One area where I do not want to sacrifice costs is for transparency. I'd rather have no government than a government without really full transparency. And the issue I see is, so I could not be more excited for the live streaming. I think that's a great step forward. I think that's going to solve a need where more people can actually view it real time and get to watch the meeting from home. That's fantastic. What I think is a challenge is, what about individuals that are working late, have other commitments, something along those lines, and perhaps don't even want to watch the whole video, but have the certain aspects they want to see? Mr. Judy, you brought up archiving, and I believe that's kind of like creating the chapters.
Indexing,
thank you. Yes. Thank you, Councilmember Willsey. So indexing, I think that's actually an important step in the right direction. And what I'd like to see is indexing at such a detailed level that it's not only indexed by item, because we have some items we saw last night. We have an item that could easily take over an hour. And what I really feel would be needed would be indexing that doesn't just have the action item, but it has you know, a beginning breakup some way, perhaps then a public comment index, where if you do or do not want to listen to all the public comment, and then indexing of more council conversation and vote. I think if we can, get to a spot where we truly have full indexing, where it's not going to take somebody 3 hours to want to listen to the portion they want, then I think that makes sense. However, I would not feel comfortable not having written record until we get to that level. So that's my thoughts on it.
Just to clarify, the written record would be the actual adopted minutes.
So what I'm referring to is
discussion.
I want the discussion, and I'd be willing. I feel comfortable with not having the written discussion if there was that extreme granular level of indexing.
Thank you. So yeah, again, because 1,000 cities in Georgia or Southeast or anywhere else doesn't do it, doesn't mean that it's not good practice. You know, a lot of people, they don't exercise. Doesn't mean that exercise is bad. So, I don't see a point that other cities, they don't do it, we don't do it. I think that we have to believe in transparency, open, and good business practice. So, and again, the video is fantastic, but it's not all. And do more in terms of transparency, in terms of opening, and good city business practice is not bad. Actually, it's really good, and it's an example. And we might see down the road a lot of city following our example, hopefully. More open and less closed in Georgia and Southeast and these wonderful countries. So, and it's a big, huge part of democracy. It's a huge part of democracy that we all have to defend every day. And having this for 17 years, having this practice for 17 years, now is not the time to kill it. So I will ask my peer council members and mayor to continue with good city business practice, continue being transparent, don't be afraid or be different. Don't be afraid, to in the name of transparency. So the cost is really $144 million budget. It's not very relevant, which is what we're offering is much more relevant than the cost in this case. And so I will continue to support the transcribing the mayor and council and committee meetings. And I would like to see also this back on the city code website, because now you cannot do a search by keywords like you used to do. You used to put any subject in the city and will come out all the meetings that council and mayor discussed about this topic. So now you can't do this anymore. And you cannot search video by keywords. So I would really like not only to reinstate them, but also to include them on the city code website, so residents, taxpayers, and the community can have a free access to all these minutes or transcriptions.
I just have a question about, I guess, the level of indexing that is available, I imagine that the video can be made searchable, correct?
Only the video can be made searchable, and I'm sure that Julie's already got. Are we already in the works on a company that's going to be doing this, the live streaming and indexing?
Well, yeah, as soon as the new budget year rolls around, yes.
But I don't think, I've never seen a very deep level of indexing. It's always been my agenda item. And correct me if I'm wrong, but I think it's a matter of one of our folks sitting in the booth and actually hitting a button to index where.
Yes, we do the indexing in post.
So can you guys know the indexing?
We can do what Mr. Palermo was suggesting, where it's public comment, vote, council discussion. We could go to that level. It's just going to take us a little more time to do it, of course. It's just staff time. And, so that's where, costs us some of our staff time and video to do that.
But I don't think you can't search.
Well, then I imagine topics.
You can scrub through.
Topics can still be searchable.
Yeah.
Because with the sorry for interrupting. With the topics being searchable to that point, because there would still be the written out minutes of votes that could be easily searched and coming up, and then seeing the vote could then go to the detailed indexing, say, you know what, I don't want to see the council part of the conversation, but I really want to see the public comment, or I don't want to see any of it, I want to just actually hear the exact motion and those exact words and get to that level of indexing.
I mean, for 20 years, I've been researching minutes, and it takes some time, and you kind of got to be a little bit of an investigator.
You get paid for it. The average resident has to do it for free.
Well, I mean, there has to be, you know, some work on the other side too. It can't just be us constantly, you know, trying to spoon feed all this information.
I'd say my responsibility is to try to spoon feed the residents. I want to make everything as easily and as accessible as possible, and I think this is a pretty easy ask given the fact that they have full-time jobs, they're paying taxes, and they're not going to always have time to listen through every second, but they do care about the decisions we make and the discussion we have.
Mayor?
Well, as Councilmember Zapata said, we've been doing this for about 17 years, and I was on council for 9 of those, and our citizens have an expectation for this. We have set the level of communication with our citizens. And I do not support taking any level of communication away from our citizens. If we have the ability to do a more granular indexing that Ms. Greco was talking about and Councilmember Zapata, I think that we could relook at this. But until we have that opportunity, I agree. We need to spoon feed this information to our citizens. That's our job. Our job is to get the information out there to folks so they can make an educated decision. So I would not support doing this until we have that level of service with the live streaming and video.
Sounds like we have that though, right? I mean, we have the technology to do that now.
The indexing, yes.
Yeah. And so if we said we wanted to index
yes,
that
we
level.
Do it with the next meeting.
So with video, it's like, think about Netflix. You can search the title of the movie, but you cannot search who was the witness of the crime at this movie. So, and this is what he's talking about here. People can search for a keyword that they're really interested in, and then everything will come out about it. So it's great to have some index level on the video, but won't get you to the detail of being able to search words. Today, the technology is not there. You cannot ask the video for a specific word and tell you everything that is during the movie that was said this specific word, like witness. Who were the witnesses of this movie? You can get it. You can get, you know, chapter 1, chapter 2, as the movie keep going, but you cannot search by keywords on movies. So I don't think that we have the technology here to do the same at City Hall. So maybe one day we get there, but not now.
How do we support, or how did, for those who are in favor of this, how do we get past the legal ramifications of conflicting documents?
I've been doing it for 17 years.
All of a sudden?
Same.
Problem. So it took 17 years to become a problem.
And but not for all of us. The other thing I would look at is if we're the only city in Georgia and we've been doing this. If we're the only city in Georgia and it's because we're embracing new technology, that's one thing. If we've been doing it for 17 years and we're the only city in Georgia that's doing it, to me that just tells me that there's a reason why other cities don't do it. And I won't support this.
So, you know, people that don't exercise, thousands of people doesn't mean that it's bad. That's so it's not an argument.
You know, I think a measure of usage and effectiveness was if we had any way to see how many times these minutes are accessed. I don't know if that data is available, but spending $60,000 a year on something that's accessed and it's costing,
how much,
$10,000. Well, we're spending $46,000 a year now on it, plus the money that we've invested in video equipment and the indexing. So, do we get enough hits on the paper minutes to make that worthwhile? I mean, what is the return on the investment that we're making? I'd also like to point out that we do provide a lot of paper documentation for in the meeting packets that would still be available for folks who want background information.
Again, for me, it's when city administrators, since it's not best practice in legal not do this. It's an easy call for me. It's like when my doctor says, don't do this, I probably shouldn't do it. My legal said I shouldn't do it. So for me, that's how it goes.
So just taking a step back, because I think even though there's definitely some differing viewpoints, I think there is a path forward. So first off, you know, I really want to thank Councilmember Zapata for even really bringing this to everyone's attention back in March. So I think that was great advocacy for transparency for the residents, and without that, we wouldn't have had the written discussions that we've had recently, and there wouldn't even be the discussion for more advanced indexing. So I'm very appreciative of that. I definitely do see some benefits, many benefits to the written discussion and the written minutes. So I absolutely do support that moving forward. And at the same time, I would also end up voting in support of moving away for it on the important sole condition that immediately that more advanced indexing would occur. Without that more advanced indexing, then I absolutely think we need to go the route of continuing the written.
So I've carefully been listening to the different parts of the discussion. I certainly have ultimate respect for the opinion of our city administrator and our council, and that's important. It's very important. I see it a little bit differently. I don't see us as taking away transparency. I see us as new video of every single meeting, that we've actually increased transparency. I think being able to see exactly what someone said, exactly how they said it, and exactly when they said it is way more transparent than what I have read in some of the versions of transcriptions that I have seen. And so I think to answer the question, what's different now than over the last number of years, the big difference is we're now providing something that is technologically way better than what we've been doing in the past. And, you know, a number of years ago, 5 years ago, you wouldn't have been able to sit in your living room and watch this video over the internet. Speeds weren't fast enough. You couldn't do these sorts of things. So. I actually see us as becoming more transparent by providing the actual videos of everything that's going on. It's very important to me to be able to see what someone said, to know that's exactly what they said and how they said it, versus having someone interpret what was said. So, and I would also just add that Councilmember Palermo's commentary about can we get them indexed down to the point of public comment, the way you laid it out, I think is very important. That would allow you to get there, you know, pretty darn quick in the video. So I'm supportive of that series of comments also.
So the transcriptions are currently housed under City Clerk's office. So Marlee, you want to talk a little bit about what they do and how they go about transcribing?
Well, first of all, there's a difference between the way we've been doing it the last couple months compared to what we've been doing the last 17 years. Before, we were kind of like cleaning up the minutes too. I mean, because a lot of times when you're in a meeting, something doesn't really make sense. We've been trying to at least make it make sense. Now what we're doing is we're just really transcribing exactly how it is said, but there's still really unofficial transcripts of those meetings. And still, from what I understand from legal, those aren't what we would use in court. They'd still be really unofficial. It does take a lot of time to do the minutes. I will give an example. Just like at a one-hour meeting, I did talk to our transcriptionist. You gotta remember, they are here part-time. They also do help at the front desk, their other tasks. We are a very, very busy city clerk office. We would love to have them do other tasks. But a one-hour meeting does not mean it only took them 1 hour to type. A one-hour meeting usually is a minimum of like 3 days for them to do. with our time. We had our meeting on May 14th. I will tell you my transcription is it took over 3 weeks to do the May 14th meeting, being over 5 hours, which is a lot of time. If what the Sunshine Law requires is very different, which is, as Bob said, who was there, what the action, what the vote was, what the action was. That's what's really required by law. It's up to you, but I will tell you that it's very, very time consuming for our transcriptionists, which was what they were hired to do. But at the same time, people do need to understand that it's not a short process. 1 hour does not mean 1 hour of time to them.
Well, we all understand that, you know, good government take time and resources to run. If you don't want to invest time and resources, you won't run a good government. So I'm not afraid of time and resources in the name of running a transparent, open, and good city business and a good government. So that's fine. I understand arguments like this, but also I understand that there is, you know, take time, yeah, and take resources. We like it or not, but it's part of the business. So, and I'm glad that it has been improved. You know, after 17 years, the last 2 months have been improved, the quality of those transcripts, and fantastic, congratulations, and that is the way to go. But it's not the way to cancel them. I mean, I understand the new council members came with the idea of getting rid of this for some reason. You know, but you have a good support of the new council member, Mr. Gary Palmer. So, again, I don't know what's the point to rush. And the video is fantastic, but not everybody is in a position to watch a video. Not everybody is in a position to listen to the audio on the video. So, having another option, another alternative, is not a bad word. It's not something to be scared of. And you know, for $46,000 a year on a $144 million budget is what, someone can tell me the percentage, but it's not too big. So again, you know, we are an example, and you know, residents are used to this, and that is a really wrong message to the community from those council members who will support getting rid of the transcript minutes. Thanks.
Once again, Marcelo, please do not put words in my mouth. I did not come to this council saying I want to get rid of this. The city administrator and our council said this is not best practices and this is not what the city should do. I've done my research, I made my own decision. I did not come wanting to get rid of this. So I would like to motion to deny moving this forward.
So motion on the floor, is there a second?
So for
clarification, please. What is the actual
reinstating transcription of audio report?
So it's an operational business practice. So I can make that decision, but as a policy, if you guys want to reinstate that, you can.
That's why I'm asking the question. I just want to make sure that we know what we're voting.
We're voting on not reinstating transcription.
Okay.
Is that the motion?
Yes.
Is there a second?
Second
by Councilmember Groer. Any further discussion? Call the roll. What do I say here? Mayor Henry?
Not in favor.
Not
in favor of commotion.
Okay, since no. Councilman Palermo?
Didn't have a crucial condition. I feel it reduces transparency. I'm opposed.
Councilman Groer?
In favor.
Councilmember Willsey?
In favor.
Councilmember Judy?
In favor.
Councilmember Tyser?
In favor.
Councilmember Zapata?
Totally opposed.
Motion carries 4-3. Okay, next item on the agenda is under finance.
So Gary, this,
yes,
if this body doesn't object, I'd like to request if we could cover number 5 before number 4. 5 is regarding the parking in lieu, and the reason being in case there might be a few residents or business owners who want to listen, and just because I think there's a little more to that one that I'd like to discuss, if that's all right, if there's no objections.
So recreation parks and everything, so we'll skip down to community development, we'll come back to finance. So item number 5 on community development, consideration of a program for fee in lieu of parking for exempted historic district properties.
Yes, that'd be fantastic, thank you. So we discussed this at the last committee meeting about 2 weeks ago. And what this is dealing with is within our historic district, properties, really buildings that were built prior to 1959 are completely exempt from parking requirements. And really the history of that, or I guess I should say some history for me, learning a lot more from staff on how that worked, is there was actually a meeting with Steve Stroud from Roswell, another council member and myself, and someone from the business community. And really they were coming in and asking about when a business transitions from one use to another more intense one, and asking about the parking aspect there. And the assumption that was given to me was that it was exempt based on use, and therefore if they switched to a greater use, then they would not be grandfathered in or exempt from that greater use. It was later found out from staff that the exemption just means they're fully exempt from it. And so what I want to do is I keep my phone in airplane mode, but I want to actually share something that I shared with some members from the HRBA, and it's just really a lot around the thought process around this. So and forgive me for any grammar issues. A quick just an exchange, which is all public record within my city email. So because from basically what's also brought this about, that was the origin where I really learned about it. But then something that I've really learned from a number of businesses in our historic district is they've raised what I think are legitimate concerns around the balance of uses. And that if we're gonna have a strong downtown, we need to have a diverse downtown. And so this was really a lot of members from the business community bringing this up, and something I strongly believe. So I just really mentioned, and a lot of my thought process is, I strongly believe our parking issues are intensified by having too little parking downtown, and then exempt buildings change uses to more intense parking uses. And an example for that, when I say more intense parking uses, for example, restaurants use more parking than retail. And so I strongly believe that having many downtown properties exempt from parking requirements, even if changing to a more intense use, makes it so businesses requiring more parking are having an unnatural demand for these exempt properties. I think that's an issue that the city government years ago has created by creating this unnatural demand, the fact that you could have two properties, one built prior to 1959, one built in 1960, one of them has a full parking requirement, one has no parking requirement at all. I have issue with this. And also I strongly believe that although this should have been done 6 years ago, there is still time to at least address this and prevent this issue from continuing worsening. Fact is, it's already bad. We already have a major parking issue. This will not solve the parking issue. This, I believe, will barely address it, or perhaps not address it at all. But what I think it will do is it will stop adding to it, and it will also stop this unnatural demand, hopefully, to address really the balance and the diversity that, because as I mentioned earlier, a diversity of uses is crucial to the long-term success of our downtown. So that is really the thought process of what I want to do here. And again, so although there were some business owners that would like the exemption to be gone, period, so that if a business changes in any way, that they would be required to meet the full parking requirement. I feel that's too extreme, I feel that's too intense. But I do strongly believe that if one of those buildings is gonna change use, to a use that uses more parking, they should be doing one of two things. They should either be coming up with the parking needed, and an example is if today they're required to have 10 spots, they have zero, they're required to have 10, and they change to a use that's required to have 15, the five is the incremental, and therefore I should believe they should either come up with the five, and a way to come up is if they end up having the five on the property, or they end up leasing spots, doing valet, finding a way to get five spots, that's one way to do it. Another way is, I think we should add, if they're not able to come up with five, or choose not to come up with five, that there should be the ability to pay a fee in lieu. And the fee in lieu would be something, and we can discuss a little more, but this is something where what I would advocate for is we would initiate not identifying that exact amount, knowing that staff would do research to come up with that right number. And in speaking with Mr. Luckett, he said for what he'd recommend is it doesn't become its own fund for different accounting and cost reasons, but he said we absolutely can have in the resolution that any penny spent in this fee in lieu could be used for parking related solutions. So it would be something that would be benefiting the business owners and residents and citizens that want to go to the downtown. So I'm gonna turn it over to Alice for important details I'm sure I'm leaving out, and just hope to get a discussion around it, because I feel we need to do something to address the diversity, or else we're just gonna continue to see that unnatural demand of these higher intensity uses. For example, restaurants have the highest intensity, and what I don't want is a couple of years from now saying, you know what, we should have addressed it when we had the chance, because it doesn't seem to be slowing down.
I had become a parking expert.
Yeah.
So I looked at this and talked to many people and researched other cities that have a parking payment in lieu of, or that are considering a payment in lieu of. And what I found was that of all of those cities, they didn't start with the parking in lieu of. And although I'm the one that said it should have been done many years ago because of the impact that it's had on parking, but what those cities did was they basically did the study and the analysis to determine what is the best approach to address parking. And I know that people say, well, we don't want another study, but this is a different study. It's not a master plan, it's not a pie in the sky, what we want to be and when we grow up. It is, if they're data driven based on parking needs and parking options. Because I know the only city in Georgia that has this is Alpharetta, and it came out of their study. And Savannah, and I gave you excerpts from Savannah, there it came out of their study, but they have not provided an ordinance to move on it. In the historic district, we have 285, give or take a few, structures that fall into the category of being older than 1959. What is difficult right now is that the majority of those properties have converted to the highest use. So you may or may not see any movement of parking in lieu of. The other thing that the council has to think about is parking in lieu of, is the cost going to be based on a deck? Is it going to be based on surface parking? The thing is, in addition to a study, and Lenore can add to this, if the desire is just to do the parking in lieu of, then that's something with time, that's because unfortunately we do have some other tasks that we have to complete. It would take working with transportation to do some type of analysis to determine what is the best cost to provide parking. Also, there's probably would need to be where. One thing that from my research is that most pushback come from the parking in lieu of is when I'm paying the money, but where is it going? What's going to be the end result? I guess I'm saying all of that because although I support a parking loop in lieu of, I'm just concerned about the possibility of not having all of our ducks in a row without doing it.
And thank you, Ms. Wakefield. That was very helpful and definitely interesting on the number of properties affected and definitely that the majority has converted to the highest parking use. And again, my concern is it's the majority. And what I don't want to see is a couple years from now, instead of saying it's the majority, it's the all, because I feel that will not create a healthy downtown. And I want to make sure that it continues to be vibrant and successful. Okay. Also, what I want to make very clear too, my goal in this and my expectation is this, is not to be raising some large fee in lieu piggy bank. That's absolutely not my goal. In reality, what I'd absolutely prefer to see is that any properties that are exempt and switched to a higher use, that they're coming up with the parking. And I'm completely flexible and supportive to find additional ways to do that. For example, increasing the distance for a valet or for off-site parking. That's something that I would absolutely support for these exempt properties. And so I want to make that clear for my goal and my reason. And also a big reason why I want to do this and I feel this is the right thing to do is I feel it levels the playing field. Because when you have different uses, I'd be concerned with the same issues if we only had retail or, you know, only had a certain use and no restaurants. I'd say we need a lot more restaurants because there needs to be balance. There needs to be multiple things for someone to do. I want to make sure the playing field is level. And the playing field is not level with this current exemption, which again, I'm absolutely confident that is an unnatural demand and why we've seen so many residents and so many business owners seeing all these conversions, because it's beneficial for a higher parking use business to want to go after one of these exempt properties because then they don't have to worry about the parking versus wanting to redevelop a newer building or something outside the historic district.
Let me add something that I was surprised about. I asked the GIS manager to provide me with the number of structures that were built before 1959. And then I asked to give me the total number of structures in the historic district. And this was surprising to me, is that there's 2,046 structures.
Wow.
In the historic district. I didn't think it was that.
And what's interesting, I feel we do have a large historic district, and I feel there are some parts of the historic district that are blighted, and at the end of the day, it's much easier to want to just really be going after these exempt properties because it's one less thing to worry about. So I stand by. There's a lot of benefits, and in talking to multiple members of the HRBA, the board, and different businesses. Everyone I spoke to is supportive. Of course, that's just anecdotal, but just from a pure logic standpoint as well, I ask you to at least support this initiation, realizing there could be certainly changes with Planning Commission first reading, but I think it's a very healthy discussion to really be having with the community.
Yeah, I do have a draft that Bob put together. The draft doesn't tell you how much, you can speak to about where, because we felt that if you're going to set fees, it's probably best to set fees by resolution.
Oh, that's right.
So you want to speak to your ordinance, Bob?
What Councilman Palermo asked for was that we make the change to the UBC that would require any change in use to trigger the payment of the fee in lieu, but the section only applies if you're increasing the number of
parking spaces needed. For instance, they're all zero right now, but they all also carry, if the exemption didn't apply, a certain number. So you would look at what the UDC would require if the exemption didn't apply, and if the use they're going to is more intense, that triggers then the fee in lieu. And what we say is that any change in use from one category set out in the applicable zoning use table to another, as required to be listed on the business license, shall require the applicant for the change use to meet the requirements of the section. So we're trying to make it very clear about when this applies and when it doesn't apply. But I believe that the fee, when you determine what that fee should be established by resolution, because you can change that as needed with just one reading, whereas if you put it in the ordinance, then it's going to require going through the entire process each time, and that's a four-month process. So I believe leave the fee out of the ordinance, put it into a resolution if you choose to go that way.
And if this council preferred, I'd be fine with not including the fee in lieu. But the reason why I like the idea of doing it is it creates just some more flexibility for those exempt properties, because this would be a new thing for those buildings. So I prefer to give them the choice. But if there was a preference to require they come up with parking, I'd support that too. But I like the idea of giving options.
So, it's a creative way to start to solve some problem. In a little while on our agenda, we're going to have a discussion of an additional way. My issue right now with initiating this by itself without some of the other items is that we create a situation where there is no in lieu. And so I'd like to get the in lieu set up, which is a less elegant way than Ms. Wakefield said. I'd like to have a lieu set up before I set up the requirement.
So,
which is kind of, I think she said that's the way the only other city in Georgia has done it, in Alpharetta. If without that in lieu piece, I want to be able to set up parking, what do I do? And so, you know, it could be further away, but what we've learned in the last couple of weeks is that those valet firms may not allow to cross Highway 9, for example. And so if we build a mousetrap that they can't get out of, I think that's a problem. So I'd like to have that problem solved. At that time, I could be very supportive of this as one of the tools to help solve the problem.
So I'd say two responses. One is, I do want to point, there's two separate issues at hand and two different problems at hand. And the bigger one is what's being discussed later today, which is there's not enough parking. What I'm proposing here, I feel, is not really solving the there's not enough parking issue. What it's addressing is the balance issue and the diversity of uses. And so, and my issue with not even initiating this until agreeing on some researched fee and lieu number is the difference in timing between a resolution and an ordinance change. This ordinance change is going to have to be initiated at a council meeting, go to a planning commission meeting, go to a first reading, go to a second reading, and at any of those times it could be deferred, et cetera. Whereas in a resolution does not need any of that process. So my concern with creating that long delay and not at least getting the ball started for this type of conversation is every single time that a building changes its use to a more intense use, which feels like it's happening constantly now, then what that's doing is that's increasing the issue that we have, and it's really minimizing the impact that this can eventually make. So I am not asking or expecting that anybody would vote for a second reading or perhaps even a first reading without having what that number is. But I do believe we should get this initiated and give us the opportunity. For me personally, again, anything we do will be better than what it is today. What today is, they require zero spots, and it's creating a lot of issues. Anything at all, no matter how, you know, low that parking new number ends up being, whatever it might be, it's still better than what we have today, and at least in a small way will address this diversity of beaches downtown, which it's not just business owners complaining about that, it is residents as well. And that's why I think we need to at least get this initiated as a big picture, knowing that nobody here is going to support a second reading, or perhaps even a first, without the greater level of detail. So if there's no other discussion, I'm ready to make a motion unless there's any other comments or thoughts.
I have one question. So Alice, as it relates to staff time and all the initiation we have going on right now, do you feel like this is something you all can comfortably take on, or do you feel like it would be better for you to have more time?
I mean, initiating it is not a problem for staff. It's just a matter of putting it on council agenda and council. Voted up, voted down. And if you voted up and we take it to Planning Commission, the difficulty with Planning Commission is we don't have the answer to a lot of the questions. That's going to be the difficulty with Planning Commission.
And do you think with more time you would have those answers? Is it just
Steve,
is it the timing?
Steve, initiation would be the 25th.
I mean, how long do you think it would take for us to come up with something reasonable in terms of a fee in lieu of?
Take a while. I mean, there's a lot of issues to balance.
On this thing we have in our packet, it's showing a year, 11 months for implementation in this one city. So this isn't a short process, well, I don't believe.
So here's what I'd like to do, because again, I do plan on motion, I do believe we should initiate it. And if the fee in lieu is the issue, I'd even want to initiate this, and I would support a fee in lieu of a dollar. Because you know what? That's better than what we have today, right? Today, they do not have to find parking, they do not have to find a penny. If we even say they either have to find the parking or pay $1, I feel we've made the code better. And I believe dollar is not the right number. I believe it should be much, much higher than that. But if that's the hesitation, let's not stop a good ordinance just because we're not positive we have the perfect dollar amount. And again, I'm not here with an agenda saying it should be $1 million or anything like that. I'm just saying we hear an issue around balance, and we're not addressing that issue for our downtown. And frankly, we owe it to our downtown and all the business owners and the residents that go there.
As we are looking at finding more, I guess, publicly funded or creatively provided parking options going forward, we'll start to get to know what the costs associated are with that. And I wonder if that parking we might also be applied to all businesses who aren't able to provide parking, but not just stores. So I think it's a big picture.
And I have concern with it for not exempt, but perhaps this could end up being a good experiment and a start where we find, you know what, maybe we should expand it. So I guess help me understand what I'm hearing is, I'm hearing hesitation because you want to make sure we have the perfect fee in lieu number. And the fact that we have nothing today, help me understand what would be the concern you'd see with passing this and having a I'm committing to supporting a resolution that even has a fee in lieu of a dollar. Where do you see as the risk? How do you see? Because I'll tell you, here's what I see as the positive and why I would support something so ludicrous as just a dollar payment, is because I truly believe this ordinance gets us a step in the right direction. And so for the resolution, I don't know what that number will be. I think I had heard from Mr. Davidson, it was originally 12,000 in Alpharetta. I think it was later changed to 7,500.
In Alpharetta, when they did their analysis, the cost for an individual parking space was $7,500. They had placed that in the ordinance, but through some negotiation, they ratcheted that down because they didn't want to negatively impact their small businesses to less than 5,000, 4,500, I believe.
And so again, I'm not looking at...
That's from February. They changed it.
And I'm not here saying what I feel the right number is. I'm not trying to here say that it should be some enormous number. I'm saying this is an ordinance that addresses a real issue. And let's initiate this. And let's know that we're all seven of us are going to work together in good faith to find what the right resolution is for the right number.
Okay, just to clarify, this issue isn't necessarily lack of parking. This is balance.
So this is, I believe, a prior council, based on this exemption, created an unnatural demand. And I feel by passing an ordinance like this, we're gonna more level the playing field and not have as large of an unnatural demand on these exempt properties. Truth be told, if the fee in lieu was a dollar, I think the unnatural demand would be identical. But if there was a more realistic number, then I think what that does is it does address the diversity and the balance.
Okay, so let me ask you this question, which I don't know the answer to. Mm-hmm. Somebody, a restaurant, does want to come into an existing retail place.
Sure.
They pay their money for parking fee in lieu, and they say, where's my parking?
Sure.
What's our answer there? That's my issue. Is yep. we're putting something in when we don't have the answer to where that money's going.
Then would you? And so I hear that concern, and then I can address it in two different ways. One way we can address that is we just don't give a fee in lieu option. We say that okay, if you want to go in retail, it requires five more spots. You're required to come up with five more spots, and then they'd have to come up with the five spots. Then your problem wouldn't exist. That's one way I fully support it. Another way I'd support it is because, again, I'm always a fan of giving more options, especially more options to businesses, is we fully disclose ahead of time. We want you to come up with the parking. We encourage you to come up with the parking and really fully do that. But then ultimately they're saying, I just paid it to you today. Where's the money I open up next week? Or where's the parking I open up next week? Well, I think what this will do, if we know we have money coming in, it gives us the ability to potentially lease or buy more spots and other ways to connect more parking. Again, I'm less concerned with that. I'm more concerned with trying to do the balance.
I guess for me, I'm just a little confused. I think we might be putting the cart before the horse, because if I had a lot here, a lot here, a lot here, or a parking deck here, and I said, we built this and we're funding this, and this is where your money's going to, then I think I could say, all right, I'm good with this. And that's kind of where I'm hung up on this. I understand what you're trying to do, and I think we're getting creative here. I just don't know if I can initiate something that I don't know where I am on it.
But so I guess,
mean, I don't know where the answers are.
Right, but I guess the irony I see in that is If we had, you know, these parking decks, we'd be in a great spot. And in fact, if we had all these parking decks, perhaps we wouldn't need our parking requirements and all of this. But because we don't, I don't think we should be stopping some good legislation and improvement addressing an issue. I think it's a change, and there's always a fear of change. But we shouldn't decide, you know what, because we're only leasing one lot and we don't have that many spots, we shouldn't do anything that addresses it. Instead, I think we should be seeing this is going to address the balance, level the playing field, and bring in money that we are immediately telling staff, we've got money, go buy us, build us, lease us the spots. I think it's only going to help be a catalyst in making sure that we have a culture here of just adding more parking. If we get the fee in lieu. In reality, they might just decide, you know what, they come up with parking, who knows.
Laura, did you have a comment?
Well, I was just going to add, you know, calculating the fee in lieu isn't necessarily the complicated part. If, you know, our staff, along with transportation, working, planning, and zoning, could probably do it in 4 to 6 weeks. The real issue is determining the basis that we would base it on. So, for example, the city of Alpharetta study, if I'm not mistaken, they evaluated that they had a space to put a parking deck. They calculated essentially what's the cost to build that parking deck and divided up a number of spaces, and voila, you have a cost. So, deck versus surface parking. And then, kind of leaning also towards, what the concern about where is that money even going to go, you can also base it on, all right, we've identified these are the areas within the city where parking could go, and this is the different types of it. So you may have a range. You may have, okay, well, this is the debt cost, this is this. So you have some alternatives. And without that direction from council, it is difficult for us to know what that number may be. We can come up with one on, you know, different size decks and different size surface parking lots, but until there's a decision on what is it that the city would want to see within its historic district or around it, choosing what that fee is maybe difficult.
And that's what the planning commission's going to need.
They do a full plan?
Yeah.
They do a full plan.
So basically an assessment that then came to that.
I'm just wondering at this point, Palermo, if maybe initiation's not the right way to get this included into our eventual solution. From what I was just listening to, if we were putting forward an idea for parking that was going to cost $750,000, okay, and as part of that, we now know that the city has a $750,000 outlay to make. Pick a number of spots, right?
And so I just want to make sure I understand your example. So you're saying if this was implemented and a change in use was occurring that was resulting in, or multiple resulting in $750,000?
No, I'm saying.
You're saying if we're buying a parking lot that's worth $750,000?
We're creating a parking lot.
Okay,
solution.
So, okay. I just want to make sure I understand.
The idea of payment in lieu to me is more to have those people who are enjoying the benefits of the business help pay the city for parking it's had to create. Okay, I think that's what Alpharetta's plan was. That's how that's what they were trying and struggling, I might add, to do. But what I'm saying is maybe what this is, the better way to do this is not through initiation as an independent piece of legislation. Maybe it's we decide that we're going to build a new lot, and that new lot is going to cost $750,000. I'm just making an example, and it's going to create 1,000 spots. We now know how much each one of those spots is, okay? And we can clearly, we can then attach this idea, right, into that piece of legislation, right? And now we know, in order to pay for this new thing, right, part of the program is going to come from, you know, how this might work. And so it doesn't then have to go through staff and through planning commission, who may or may not, you know, have the whole picture of what might be going on. And we pass it basically in two readings, right? Because we know what we're trying, the dollars we're trying to cover. So I think it's something that is absolutely part of our solution. I'm questioning whether initiation or whether, as we get through the rest of today's agenda, right, we may say, hey, we like this idea, right? We'd like it even better if we had a way to pay for it.
Yep. So in an ideal world, in an ideal situation, I see a lot of good merit behind that. Here's the challenge I see with that, is there is a timer on this, and the timer is that every week that goes on, and an existing retail store, art gallery, vacant location, anything like that, it turns into the highest use item, which is a restaurant. And so the problem is, 6 months out, this is not as valuable as an ordinance as it is 2 months out. And so the issue is, we're going to continue to see locations in our downtown Roswell turn into a restaurant. And I feel we're really hurting our diversity around town. Because again, today is not passed. If today was passing with the law, I'd say, absolutely, let's hold off. We don't need to do it today. But what I'm trying to do today is, let's start the conversation for the possibility that 2 months from now, this is law. And I'll tell you right now, even if it does pass today, to initiate, 2 months from now, there will be multiple non-restaurants today in our downtown that become restaurants, and I believe the unnatural demand is a part of that. So that's my issue with the fact that when making a decision, it's a decision to say we'll make a change 2 months from now. So that's why I have issue with waiting a few months to having some ideal solution in the future.
Sure. Yeah, because I mean, that is not stopping. Now going to your point, it's an ongoing thing that the more you wait, the deeper the problem becomes. You have this address, you know, 10 years ago would be one thing. 5 years from today would be a different thing. So it's an ongoing situation. So no addressing this right now doesn't help at all. I mean, make it worse. So And that is just one piece of the puzzle to resolve the problem. So, and I think managing two items is not that big of a deal, even if they are in separate files or agenda items. It's not that complicated, and we all know that there's a lot of items here that they are related somehow, and we can still manage to discuss and move forward individually. So I'm supportive of trying to address something that needs to be addressed many years ago, and the more that you wait, the more problem that start generating in the area. So.
I think it's a creative idea. I do think if we're going to charge a fee, we have to be able to deliver something. And right now, I don't think we're at a place where we can do that.
So
I think this is part of
the strategy. Would you support removing the fee then? If I make my motion to exclude the fee in lieu.
What's really the point?
The point is they'd have to come up with more partners.
Well, I think that is also a challenge because as we do things like lease lots, you know, we're taking away potential options for them to go out and find extra parts.
So
I think it's a big strategic decision that we need to look at, you know, holistically rather than just trying to write an ordinance.
Absolutely. So, and actually, to your point and to Councilmember Tyser's point, I've actually got another way to look at it that I think would do exactly what you're describing. So we have a lot that we're leasing for a 3-year lease that I believe is $3,000 a month. And so, yeah, so let's just say $36,000 a year. And right now it's just a 3-year lease. I'd love to be able to create parking solutions in perpetuity instead of just in 3-year increments. And so right now we have an official cost. And I think there could be other opportunities in addition to the very clever one here today. But what if we did it purely based on that? We have a lot that currently is only a 3-year lease. We just want to take it by that price. It will be a very small amount. And so you owe 10 spots. By doing the math, that means you owe, you know, $10, I'm using fake numbers. They're getting exactly what they're paying for. They're getting their spots. We're getting a good ordinance, and we're getting time to do more research to see is a different number more appropriate. But we have that today.
So that was sort of my point, was not to delay, not to be accused of delaying, but to say I don't have to go through the initiation process and run something to the Planning Commission and go through a 2, 3, 4, 6, however many month process this might be. I could just write the legislation.
I thought by law to change the UDC, I thought we had to go through the process.
Yes.
Yeah.
So this is changing the UDC piece.
Because the exemption is in the UDC. The UDC says any building built prior to 1959 requires no parking. So I agree with that. That's why I want to just initiate this, knowing it's going to be thought out for what we do when we talk to first and second readers for the right number. And again, right here I'm saying, I don't care how low the number is. Today, sure, the number is zero.
Can I make a suggestion? If, as I mentioned, if the council wants to initiate it, so then it's out. I think we did this before on something that's initiated. Allow staff the opportunity to do the analysis before we take it to the Planning Commission. Because truthfully, we're going to bring it back to you before we go to the Planning Commission, because you might not agree with what we find, and then we move it to the Planning Commission, and we can do the two readings at council, you know, back to back.
I don't love it, but I am a man of compromise.
We can get something done.
Make the motion. Your motion.
So I motion to initiate, knowing that it will not go to Planning Commission until staff has done the research on it.
So motion on the floor. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilmember Judy. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Hey, Tom.
Thank you, Alex.
And this is the expert that I said last time, bringing up it to more than 6 years ago.
See what happens when you listen to staff?
Yeah.
All right, Ryan, you're up. So we're back on the finance
number 4
on the agenda. Consideration to approve fiscal year 2018 year-end budget.
these are just a few items that we kind of go through at the end of each year. You know, look through our expenses for the year and minor adjustments that need to be made to the budget. So you're not going to see new projects or new programs or anything like that. It's more of items that we feel need to be cleaned up before we finish up the fiscal year and properly walk through each of those items.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. So as Brian said, this is a process that we go through at the end of the year, and all of these items are staff recommended budget amendments. So we'll start with the general fund. In the revenue, so we are recommending recognizing additional revenue from sale of assets of $8,000, and this is basically the surplus of our assets that we do. So that's $8,000. And then we are also suggesting recognizing additional revenue from insurance reimbursement of $823,179. And a major portion of that is the reimbursements that we've received for RAPSTIC, for the repairs at RAPSTIC, and that's a little over $777,000. So that's a total revenue recognition of $831,179 in the general fund. And moving on to the expenditure portion, the first item that we have is the legal fees. We expect the legal fees to be over budget this year, and so we are recommending a budget amendment of $225,000 for that. And then the next item that you see is the expenditure recognition of professional services. We are expecting an increase, and that's the $8,000, and that's going to be covered by the revenue that you see the first time, the $8,000, so that we make up for that. The third item that we have in the general fund is to recognize additional expenses, and these are the insurance claims, and that is $823,179. And you see the revenue for that again at the top, the $823,179. And then the last item that we have here is the general fund transfer to the hotel fund of $160,000. And this is the fund out of which we pay CBB and Roswell Link. And so this $160,000 will cover the remainder of the payment that we have to make to CBB. And that's mainly because our revenues in the hotel fund are coming in below what we had projected. So to summarize, we have the estimated FY18 current fund balance over reserve by policy at $448,417. The total revenue that we are proposing recognizing is $831,179. So that would give us a total estimated available funding of a little over $1.2 million. And the total general fund expenditures that we have is $1.2 million. So that would leave us with an ending fund balance over reserve at policy of $63,417 at the end of FY18. Moving on to the hotel motel fund. So I had talked about the $160,000 earlier in the general fund. So this is the general fund transfer to hotel motel fund of $160,000. And then we are also proposing a decrease in the expenditures in the hotel motel trail fund of $41,750. And again, the reason for doing that is because we are, the revenues are not coming in as expected. And then we have the workers' compensation fund. Again, here, the expenses have come in higher than expected because of some large claims. So we are requesting Mayor and Council to allow this budget amendment of $220,000. The estimated current fund balance is $933,105. And with the budget amendment, we would be left with a fund balance of $713,105. Next is the group benefits fund. Now here again, the expenses have come in higher than expected, but we have also received some reimbursement from the city's stop loss insurance, and that is an amount of $680,774. So the estimated current fund balance over reserve and policy in this fund is at $255,093. So there's a washout between the revenues and expenses, and that would leave us with a fund balance or reserve at policy of a little over $255,000. And then we have the Fleet Services Fund. We are recommending a budget amendment here of reducing the budget in the Fleet Services Fund by $50,000. And this is basically because we expect the ending fund balance to be negative, and by reducing this budget, that would help us make the fund balance positive at the end of FY18. And that's $50,000. And by doing that budget amendment, we would have an estimated remaining fund balance of $23,474. We then have the TSPLOS fund. Again, here in this particular fund, the revenues have not been coming in as expected. And we expect, so we are requesting to reduce the revenue budget by $350,000. We have a current fund balance of a little over $503,000 in the TSPLOS fund. And with that, by reducing the revenue, we would be left with a fund balance of $153,415. The federal grant fund, this that you see here is basically, we are requesting an increase in both revenues and expenditures by $43,789. And that is to recognize the reimbursements that we have received, or going to receive actually, from JMA for expenses that were incurred as a result of Hurricane Irma. And then those are the associated expenditures. So that's $43,789. We then have the confiscated assets fund. Now, this is a request to increase the expenditures in this fund by $17,300. And this is for the purchase of a canine. And this is to replace canine's art that was sold. So that's $17,300. And we propose using the fund balance to buy the canine. We have a current fund balance of $596,156. And by increasing the expenditure by $17,300, we expect the remaining fund balance of $578,856. And this slide here basically gives you a summary of what the impact of each of these revenue and expenditure increases is going to be on all of these funds. Any questions?
Floor is open. You guys are for a vote to move to the agenda?
Yes.
Is there a motion?
Motion to approve.
Motion by Councilmember Zapata. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilmember Groer. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Captain. Okay. We're down under addendum. Item number six, consideration for county library improvements and shared parking lot. Should take consideration.
So a quick intro to this, the county came to us with library renovations coming fairly soon with some ideas that they could potentially help us with parking. They are moving pretty fast on their renovation, and so if we want to do this, we're going to probably have to move quicker than we can move. So we have some design or concepts that show here, and we're going to have to work with the county on ways to collaborate with that.
So. Thank you, Councilmember Groer. So just to add some context to what Councilmember Groer said, the county is going to renovate the library, which is right over here. And there's mostly an internal operation. I can tell you, in the pre-app, we saw they're not changing the footprint. They're going to shave off the shingles and put a new roof on it. And probably most notably, which I think a lot of us think is long overdue, is currently the only access to the library is here off the parking. This is just Pete Skinner, Norcross, and Fraser Street. They are going to add a pedestrian entrance off of Norcross, which, given the increase in pedestrian traffic, both with the residences and the businesses that are coming and the other ones that are on the horizon, we think that is a terrific new addition to the library to be more pedestrian friendly. The task that you have given the transportation department is to look at the number at the site and see if there is a way to increase parking. And so I'm going to walk you through, the staff has taken a little bit of leeway in some concepts, and we're just going to sort of bounce those off you right now. But the issue on the table is, if we want to partner with the library, we cannot ask the library to add parking. They don't need any additional parking. We would like additional parking. So the onus is on us to fund that, to basically modify their design to accommodate our needs. So this is what we're looking at so far. We have Fraser Street here, and we're going to do this anyway. This is our road, and I can just tell you, you'll see this consistent. We've added 5 new spaces. We pre-marked those out, and when our striping contractor gets here, we're going to add 5 new spaces in that acceleration lane that we really don't need. Now it comes into two. So some options that we have are to change Josephine Skinner. It's currently 2 directions, full access at both entrances. One way to add more parking would be to modify the traffic flow and have it as northbound only with a right turn out. You could also add a pedestrian crossing here, because there will be more pedestrian crossings. I want to say that in the next couple scenarios, if we want to change Josephine Skinner, that's within our right and it's our property. The issue from the transportation staff is, what's going to do is, this intersection at Norcross and Fraser is already pretty low level of service, and this is going to make it worse. So we're probably going to need to do a intersection improvement. At some point we talked about a roundabout. That might be a little bit of a stretch, maybe an aspirational thing. There might need to be some turn lane improvements. But any of these issues that you see where we change the traffic flow and just make Skinner is going to generate the need for some traffic calming, or not traffic calming, an intersection improvement. So this is on-street improvement. Then we talked about making some modifications to the site. You see that they have sort of this, it's sort of a seating area, like a little park, like a little pocket park in the middle, where we could possibly modify that and add 20 new spaces.
Can I address that?
Yes, sir.
When we met with the folks from the county, they told us that that area was supposed to be used for like a chill kind of park type place. Mm-hmm. They want to encourage people out front, so they're going to put benches and stuff out front of the building to encourage people to go out there. So losing that space in the middle with the new entrance in the front isn't that big of a deal.
Great, that's good. Thank you.
And let me just add one thing. I wasn't terribly excited about this whole idea because I didn't think the location was very good until we were standing there. And with Skillet property and the distillery and Variant basically 100 feet away, as well as when you're standing on the corner there at Josephine Skinner, you'd see up the hill, you're not far at all from Standard and the rest of Cannon Street. So I think an important piece of this will be signage to point people here, because it doesn't really look like somewhere you think, oh, let's park there, but it actually is extremely convenient to a lot of the downtown hotspots.
Okay, so here's just, and these are just staff estimates of some things that we could do. I also forgot to point out that we'd also talked about changing the orientation of the entrance here down on Josephine Skinner. So rather than we sort of take out that there's a median right there, a landscape median, and it's got a left and a right turn. We don't really, that's way over capacity for this, so we put some more spaces there. So this other scenario is is we would change this to the one-way northbound with this right turn out, and we would do back-end angled spaces to get more. Also does not require any widening of the curb. We just repurpose the asphalt that's out there, and then we sort of jam in some more spaces here in the center to get a few more spaces. And then this is sort of another scenario where we really do widen the road to accommodate back-end angled spaces on both sides of the road, but we would need some retaining walls and some other things. So all this to say is the staff has done, and Muhammad was there, I unfortunately was out of town, and he can add any, so council, or Commissioner Hausman was there, right, representing the Fulton County Library System, and sort of gave us the opportunity to partner with them on these different things. And the issue is we would need to get money, because we do not have any budget for this right now in the transportation department, to get for design and then eventually for construction of these. So we don't know that this is the final answer. All we're saying is that we see certainly some options for, and there's even more options.
Right.
If we went over here on Forest Street, man, if you, there's a topography difference. This parking is higher than the street, so if we did any more parking along the street, it would require some retaining walls, lighting, and there's two other factors. One is, well, I guess it's the same factor twice, but one would be, does this impervious surface create any needs for detention or water quality? So talking to the city engineer, it is possible that we could trigger those requirements. So what we really need at this point is to hire a professional consultant, either our own consultant that they are approving, or modify their existing site engineering design. And we are asking right now, back of the envelope would be somewhere around $100,000 to $150,000 for them to basically prove these concepts or come up with some concepts of their own, and then give us some cost estimates for construction.
I thought when we discussed this, there was 125 to 150 spaces. What's
that was
there?
On the side. We used this side as well. So we went this side, and then we.
It's a total of 155. We're looking at right there.
So we did that. So.
That's just 100.
Okay, so this, and then we had this side in as well. We looked at that. And we brought this, I think, did we bring it further down, Sean?
I don't know.
I can't.
This was before we talked to these guys. And,
right.
You know, the request of transportation was to max out what we can on Josephine Skinner and then the central.
The other thing is if we do this, and Mr. Aceback, this is a question for you. I think the important part of this is taking streetlights down both sides from here down with sidewalks to the area, because that's going to be important to access this parking and make it a parking friendly to walk toward Camp Street and around in this area, because right now it's pretty dark in this area.
Okay.
This group here, the new place right here, has same street lights that are in downtown Roswell on Camp Street right there. So we would want to extend that both sides, kind of like a corridor.
It's almost a streetscape.
Right, going down.
Okay, well, so.
I think some of that is included in the library.
Well,
like
if we're gonna make the investment, we gotta make it comfortable for people to park in and walk to the necessary areas.
Okay.
Otherwise, I feel it's wasted parking.
Okay.
So you need from us. I think we need to work with probably Commissioner Hausman to try to figure out the most creative way for us to. First of all, the decision as to whether we are in favor of this for $100,000 for the design, roughly, and the most creative way for us to work with the county.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
The, this is what is presented on the pack today to the, take a decision. This is what is presented in a committee meeting pack today. That is unacceptable. Look at this. See? What is this? So to make a decision on this, to see if we can move forward with this level of information, presenting to the public and to the council, that is unacceptable. So definitely we need to get more information here in the pack before we move anything forward.
This was an addendum.
Well, so why don't we talk about this again later when you have more information on the pack for the public and council.
As Councilmember's pilot, for the past 15 minutes, Mr. Grayson Brock has been making a presentation to us with visuals, and I'm sure those visuals can be made available to you immediately after the meeting.
But these have not been available to study for anybody. No council, no public, no community, nobody. So I think that, you know, you might want to consider to put a more detailed pack for the public in advance for the next meeting.
Well, you can blame me for that. That wasn't the transportation director. So I'll take the hit on that one.
Anyway, I think it's a great idea. We need to look at it and further it. If council members need more time, I think there's a presentation going on and we should sit and watch it. Figure out what's going on here and to make a decision. So I'm kind of at a loss here.
If we needed more time, Councilmember Palermo's, I think, still here. What would that look like? Is it 2 weeks? Is it a week? What are we talking about?
I think all we need right now is a general idea of whether we're in favor of this. I don't know that this needs to go to the agenda yet. But
I agree. We need to figure out
we
more.
With
we just need
Alden.
To. Yeah. We don't have any. We have no mayor, no two council members. We can't.
I think it's a great opportunity to take advantage of some investment in county's doing right now. It really plays off a very pivotal area with Southern Spillet, with things around at City Hall and potentially the Cultural Arts Center. I think it's something we should
not
slip away.
And I don't think that this is the right way to show the county that the city is interested in this. So my recommendation right now is yes, we are, at least in my position, I'm in favor of this. I will work with Commissioner Hausman, figure out the best way to work together, and then we'll bring it back.
Can we put this on the next committee, please?
Sure.
We'll defer.
So is that a motion?
Motion to defer.
So it's next committee?
Yes.
You're second on that?
Second
by Councilmember Judy. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you.
Thanks, Steve. Thank you.
Okay, now we are on to the Public Safety and Public Works Committee regular meeting. First item on the agenda is the approval of the minutes of the Public Safety and Public Works Committee meeting on May 15, 2018.
So we have
another motion to approve.
We have another agenda item.
Can we take five? Let me see if I can find the council members.
Okay, I'll just recess for five.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's not there.
Oh, here it is.
Yes, how are you doing?
Thank you.
You want to
jump?
Let's go.
Let's get them back in here. Let's get them back in here.
Stop.
Is there a motion on the floor to defer the remaining items on this agenda?
Yes, motion to defer.
We'll get back to that. So we're still on the public, we're still on the prior agenda because there's one more item on there that I missed. So we're still on the admin financing. Right, so there's a motion to adjourn. A motion to defer that item. Okay, now we're going to go to the public safety, public works meeting.
Do you need a vote on that?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Second.
Second by Councilmember Judy, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Public safety, public works committee meeting. Is there a motion on, we got one item, I guess. Chief, do we need to do that target item?
We need approval.
Well, we can approve that.
Okay, consideration resolution to accept the 2018 target engagement. Community engagement funds of Ransom for Roswell National Night Out, $1,000.
Yes, sir. This, I came before y'all a few weeks back. It was actually a $2,000 grant from Target that we submitted. They approved $1,000. We actually have $1,000, I believe. They've already sent the check to us. So it's here. So I'll just come back before you to get that approved to accept it. Okay. Floor is open. Any discussion?
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve by Councilmember Judy. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilmember Willsey. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thanks to you. Is there a motion on the floor for the other items?
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn by Councilmember Judy. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Councilmember Tyser. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
We're adjourned.
Talk about the public case thing down by the front desk. Okay.
So there's nothing there about this meeting? Okay. All of those are in check.
So I'm not being like me, but I'm out of grace because there are a lot of new members on
the tea drive.
And just because they've been doing it a certain way,
fully agree with you. Yeah.
I'll
look into that and make sure that we're at a minimum in compliance with the law. So that's concerning to me, too.
Well, how many members of the public realize?
I don't know. A couple, maybe, if any.
I don't think the public realizes it.
Yeah, could be.
I really don't.
I'll follow
they
up on
know.
That. You have a good week. You have a good week.
Okay.
You need me for anything, Linda? You guys good?
No, I'm just going to review the sound. Looks like everything worked okay.
Okay.
Thank you.